Steve, I'd like to say a few things, a few basic things, because I think the questions that our neurologists ask us, besides the issue of what happens if it doesn't work, is are they safe and how effective are they and are they different from what we have
now?
Well,
you're going to have your talk about fibenzabab and nipinzumab, so you can talk about those briefly, and then now you'll have all four to discuss.
Okay. First question is safety. And we have with some of these monoclonal antibodies now, for example, with arenumab, we are beyond 4 years in patient exposures, over 200 patients beyond 4 years. Thousands of patients have been exposed for years to fremanezumab, to arenumab, galcanezumab. So we really are beginning to have a very large safety database. And for the subcutaneous injected ones, which are galcanezumab, arenumab, and fremanezumab, there's some irritation at the injection site that's more than placebo. There are a few sniffles that occur with some of them and some constipation, but we're really not seeing significant safety adverse events. And arenumab in particular was given in a study for patients with what I would have called unstable angina, patients having angina every month, and did not appear to worsen angina or change exercise tolerance tests when compared to placebo. So on the safety side, although we're always monitoring, and these are new drugs, I think we have every reason to be encouraged, and tolerability, as David said, is excellent.
And no liver enzyme issues.
Yes, it's not metabolized.
Worthwhile saying across the entire development program.
Yeah. Right.
Or kidney issues.
It doesn't interact with the reticuloendothelial system.
Right. And they don't interact with other drugs. I just mention?
And that's a beautiful thing, not having drug-drug interactions.
Just going to the one thing about cardiac safety, I think it's important that we recognize that patients with significant cardiac issues were not in these clinical trials. So there is that small trial with arenumab in patients with stable angina, but it was a very small group of patients, and that as clinicians, we need to be aware of that and consider that if we're thinking about prescribing this in a patient with who's had a heart attack in the last several months or who had a stroke last year, because we don't have information at this point about if there's going to be any complications. And I think that's important.
I think
to
it's important to back up and ask ourselves, why are we even having this conversation, right? And it's all about antagonizing the effect of a potent vasodilator. I'll say a couple of things. One is that it's not the only potent vasodilator in the human body. There's a lot of redundancy in the system for good reason. That would be number one. So if you antagonize the effect of one, you may not affect vasomotor tone. Number two, when you apply the receptor antagonist or the antibodies to an isolated blood vessel, whether it's a coronary or you name it, it doesn't constrict the vessel. So it's not a direct vasoconstrictor effect. The concern is if someone's already having myocardial ischemia or cerebrovascular ischemia and they're going to have a stroke or a myocardial infarction, could you expand or increase the size of the infarction because you've taken out something that might provide dilation of collateral blood vessels? I think that's the concern. And so people should be aware of the fact that these don't directly constrict blood vessels. And the only reason we're talking about it is that it antagonizes the effect of one vasodilator in the human body.
Very important issue. And in the article that was published using arenumab in angina patients, there was a letter to the editor by the Scandinavian group criticizing the trial and basically claiming that, yes, they believed the results, but perhaps these were people who had fixed stenotic lesions, were not vasospastic, and it may not apply to everybody. So I think here's the way I would look at it. There's absolutely no evidence they cause any problems. But as somebody once said, the absence of evidence doesn't prove anything.
Although, interestingly, in terms of safety, there's a neurologist talk about this because of the MS monoclonals. These antibodies have been engineered on the Fc end not to interact with the immune system. They simply don't have any immune modulating effect. So there's no baggage for infections and such.
We got to stop at that point. That is the crucial issue. If you listen to television, half the ads are for an antibody, and you hear people say you're going to get tuberculosis or this or that. And I think the crucial issue is, I always say, it's not the antibody that causes the problem, it's what the antibody does for a living that causes the problem. And basically, if antibodies were dangerous, we'd be all dead because we have tons of antibodies. The concentration of our own antibodies is 1,000-fold what we give when we give a monoclonal antibody. And just remember, antibodies are Y. The top interacts with the antigen. The bottom of the Y is what can cause problems. These have all, as Peter said, been genetically engineered to not interact with the immune system. So therefore, by definition, they do not cause those problems.
We need to think about this as immunopharmacology, not immune modulation. FAB fragment pharmacology on CGRP pathways without any FC and immune modulation. It's very important because our colleagues are so used to these concerns. Yeah. And that's one of the most exciting things about this, really. It's a completely different
clean.
Way of thinking, clean, and thinking about how to manipulate pharmacology.
Which brings us back to efficacy. And how do they differ from the preventive medicines we were talking about? Besides the fact that they're designed, besides the fact that they're clean, besides the fact that they appear so far safe and tolerable, they have a number of features from an efficacy standpoint that are extremely hopeful for our patients.